We're looking for any, what we want to do is extend the range down of the horned Pectinitis and increase the range up, if we can, of subdichotomosaurus with the lappets. See, the idea is to try and find the male ammonites to see whether that. So you're getting these subdichotomosaurus come up here, they range up here, which Cope never thought they did, but they do. And where the first horned Pectinitis comes in, he's found it way down below Yellow Ledge here somewhere. Well, I've not found it, but that's a collecting deficiency, perhaps on my part, you know what I mean? So, but to find anything well preserved is bloody difficult because they're not that common. So you look along here, I mean, the best chance would be here somewhere, you know, on these clear bits, but the rest of it you see is all weed covered, so you can't. It's a bit of a, yeah. And that's where, you know, you get the thing slung at you. Well, collecting fossils is irrelevant, but what it does in point of fact here, if you look at the whole picture, and then you can work out the, and they can now with it, what the fossils you find, isotopic analysis, they can work out ocean temperatures, depths, and temperatures, air temperatures, and, you know, sea temperatures. Well, that's quite useful if we're going through global warming periods, you know, when this period was as warm as well, you know what I mean? And this is the top of the lower Kimmeridge clay, the last ammonite zone. And this is where they disappear. But like I say, it's difficult to find that. He's noticed it in boreholes, I haven't. I mean, he said they're very, very, you know, the Alicus stephanus ammonites are very small. Well, you know, different parts of the country I've seen in Oxfordshire, just at this level, massive great Alicus stephanus, big flat ammonites. The ones we see in the bay, you know those ones? I see those. Then Gravesia, which is another ammonite which we find here as well, but I've never looked for the small one, so I don't really know. What I was saying to Ramus is, are you sure the boreholes you're examining actually are not deficient of some of the beds? In other words, we found some there in the bay. They're small Alicus stephanus. Remember I showed you, I said they're small ones. They're like the ones he sort of found. Are these beds here cut out? And what he thinks was the top of the Kimmeridge in the boreholes and actually not the top. Well, they are. There's another one. So that is subdichotomosaurus again. Big coarse ribs, yeah? And then we go up higher. See, this is the other thing that's interesting. As we go up higher, so there's these Pectinitis ammonites, which look the same, but they're much finer ribs. And they go down, we find them in Kimmeridge Bay, down as far as the Maple Ledge Stone Band. And so they sort of overlap there. And then these carry on above this. Now, this, when we get up there, that hard organic band there is what we call Blake's Bed 42, which is the boundary between the upper and lower Kimmeridge clay sort of thing. And above that, we still get these, because what's characteristic with the males with these is they got lappets, and the other ones, Pectinitis, develop a horn. But in that first ammonite zone in the upper Kimmeridge clay, they're not horned. It's only towards the top, towards Yellow Ledge, that we find them with these horns. So it's a bit of a problem. And it's a bit of, these were called, what were they called? What was the name for these? Propectinitis once. But they're not, they're subdichotomosaurus. So there's, oh, bloody ammonites drive me mad, really. No horn on that. See, there's the end of it. Can't see a horn there, can you? That's not, that's just, see what I mean? There's still this sort of thing where subdichotomosaurus, which have got much coarser ribs, they thought was originally the ancestor to these. And, you know, how do these things, suddenly all these Pectinitis Ammonites of this shape suddenly swing in, you know what I mean? Suddenly quickly, and those, but those don't sort of die out, they come up through as well a bit. So I don't think they're the ancestor to those, you know what I mean? And why did, no one's ever sort of gone theory, why did the lower Kimmeridge clay have lappets, and what were the lappets there for? And why did these upper Kimmeridge clay ones have horns? No one's ever explained what they're for, you know what I mean? And that's what I'd like to understand, or try and get a handle on. What did these things represent, and why are we getting intersexual ones? Well, what does that tell us? Why, and what use is the horn? What use is the lappet? It's got to be some use. And again, why, we know, why do some ammonites have spines? Why are some disc-like? Some, why are some fat? You know, there are reasons for those shapes. And again, the diet of ammonites is not that well known. I know some feed on plankton, but not all of them. Some were so bloody big they wouldn't feed on plankton. They want a bit more substantial meal than that. There is a sort of theory on some of these things that people, some people believe that ammonites were hermaphrodites. So, see, there's one there. Look, there may be, that might be useful. That's the sort of thing you're looking for, you see. So, what we're looking for is, lap it on there, can you see?
Mm-hmm. Is there a horn and there's not, is there? See what I mean?
Is there a horn and there's not, is there? See what I mean? Yeah? So what you could do, you could, in point of fact, collect that one. That's definitely a Pectinitis, but they haven't got the horn, so we're way down, we're not far above Blake's bed 42. Look, if you look behind you,
that's Blake 42.
Yeah. So we'll leave that there for now. But that's quite a good one. It's a definitely microconch. It's not got a horn. If you're going through all these beds, you've got to, when you're collecting, you collect bed by bed here, you'd see, you'll get in the same bed big ones and small ones. And then the guys worked out that, hang on, the small ones probably have got a lappet or whatever. They've got to be the males to those big ones. You know what I mean? Some beds we found microconchs and no macroconchs at all. So, and Aspidosteris, you know, what's the macroconch to that? Is an ammonite called Sutineria that, like I said to you yesterday, a lot of people didn't accept, but it's got to be, you know, the male. But sometimes you'll find in all just females and no males, or vice versa, you know. But don't forget, these are dead ammonites. They're not, you know, these things might have drifted for days in the water column, you know, across the seas, and, you know, got waterlogged and come down here or whatever. And then look, there is a rare one called Gravesia. See how different it is? Smooth, and then slight rib, big ribs. Look at these big, it's only half of one. And that's a, you find they're very common on the continent here. Well, until I started, they were so rare, there was only two and a half in the museums. Actually, they're common as hell, and they range a long way. But that's due to me seeing them collecting, you know what I mean? It's really a collecting, it's a collecting deficiency. That's all it is. I've extended the range of those, and as we go through time, the ribs become less coarse, and they're actually flat, you know? If it's a nodule, and it is, it's not very good though. it's ammonite shape, but you know, too. Horrible pyrite. Little bivalves in there, look, all 3D there, look. See them? Can you see them?